Hello. I've had a few people reach out to me and ask me for some information on my plane. I guess they're curious about some of its specs and what I've got in the panel. So I thought I'd take a few minutes, walk you through the plane, show you the panel, and talk a little bit about an upgrade I'm getting done in the next few weeks that I'm really excited about. I hope you enjoy it. So Oscar is a 1977 Beechcraft Sierra C24R. The 24 tells you that it's a Sierra. The C means it's the third generation Sierra, and the R just means retractable gear. The Sierra is part of what's called the Musketeer family of planes, which includes the original Musketeer, the Sport, the Custom, and the Super 3, and the Sundowner. But the Sierra is the only one that came with retractable gear.
So these are not the fastest things, they're no speed demons, they're not going to be winning any races, but they're nice and comfy. I mean, it's a little bit hard to tell with nobody sitting next to me, but when Bruna's next to me, even when Neil is next to me, our shoulders don't even touch, so these cabins are nice and wide, nice and tall, but that does come with a speed penalty. That said, I am doing about 135 true at 8,500, 8,600 feet, burning about 10.3 gallons per hour. So it's not too bad. I could pull back to 9 gallons per hour and 65% power. I'd probably go down to about 124 knots at this altitude. And my usual altitude is around 5,000 feet. It's more like 121 knots, 122 knots at 65%, and about 128 knots at 75%.
When I bought Oscar back in 2020, the panel was mostly original with just a couple of additions. Back in the 80s, the owners at the time added the Century 3 autopilot, which actually still runs really well. And then in the 2000s, the owners added this Garmin 430 WAS, which also runs really well. And at the time, they took the Collins and relegated that to the number 2 navcom position. One of the things I've always liked about it is this giant cargo door at the back. There are not too many planes in this class that actually have a third door like this. Actually, not too many of them even have two doors, let alone the third door. And this one's so big that we can actually fit our bikes in. And we often will do that. We'll put our bikes in the back and go for a flight somewhere and just go for a ride. As longtime viewers will know, I've had some interesting issues with my plane since I bought it less than 3 years ago. It's about 46 years old, and as with any old plane, it has the occasional hiccup. Pretty soon after buying Oscar, I had to get new exhaust headers made, replace the mags, replace the entire engine when we found a crack in the crankcase, and then replace the alternator on the way home from the Bahamas. Other than the mechanical fixes, though, I haven't really done much with it, other than putting in a JPI engine monitor, putting in a FlightStream 210 to allow the 430 to communicate with my iPad, and a couple of little things here and there. But I have decided it's time to bring Oscar into the 21st century. So I'm getting an upgrade done in a couple of weeks that's going to get rid of all the old steam gauge six-pack instruments and replace them with something a bit more modern, a bit digital. I've been looking at options pretty much since I bought the plane, taking a look at everything from uAvionix, Garmin, Avidyne, and Aspen as well. I've looked at full glass panels down to just a couple of little round instruments to replace the six-pack itself. Both of them, though, would let me get rid of the vacuum pump, which I am not a fan of. I've also considered updating my radio stack. The 430 works really well. The Collins is starting to show its age a little bit. Still generally works pretty well, but it is starting to have issues. And I've considered their Garmin equipment, of course, as well as the Avidyne IFDs. As others who've upgraded the panels will tell you, of course, there's pros and cons to all of these devices. There's no one device that's perfect for everybody. So let's talk through a little bit some of the factors I considered when making my decision. It needed to be IFR capable, including a proper HSI and glide slope, both ILS and GPS capable. Next, it needs to be compatible with my old Century 3 autopilot, which still works really well, so I don't really see a need to replace that. It needs to be compatible and integrate fully with the existing GNS 430 WAS, including the ability to cross-fill flight plans and other data. It needs to be able to integrate with my iPad and my iPhone to cross-fill flight plans, and it needs to offer an upgrade path that wouldn't limit future upgrades if I do decide to go full glass panel at some point. And speaking of future compatibility, eventually I might put a Garmin GFC 500 autopilot in there. So if and when I choose to upgrade the Century 3, whatever I choose has to be compatible with the Garmin autopilot. The company has to offer really good support, and there have to be lots of service options in terms of avionics shops around with experience servicing the equipment. And finally, of course, cost. Avionics upgrades are not cheap, and I didn't want to spend any more than necessary, keeping in mind other requirements. Now, the cost factor meant that I would not be going with a full glass panel this time out. Those panels are just crazy expensive once you factor in all the other changes you need to make in order to support them. So that really left three options for replacing my six-pack. The uAvionix AV30C, the Garmin G5, and the Garmin GI275. Pretty early in the process, I knew the AV30C wouldn't work. It doesn't support autopilot guidance right now, and it doesn't have a glide slope for IFR flight, and those are must-haves for me. I was actually a little surprised at how many issues that unit has that make it less than ideal for someone in my position, which is probably a lot of people. And so that left the G5 and the GI275. Unfortunately, the less expensive G5 can't be a primary replacement for my full six-pack, which would have meant leaving in the original airspeed indicator. And that ASI was actually one of the main things I wanted to get rid of, because it has mile per hour markings on the outer ring, while I did my training, and I do all my planning and thinking, in knots. So I've always found it to be a bit annoying having to go back and forth between those two units. Getting a G5 meant I'd still have that issue, since the airspeed scale on the G5 should ideally match what's on the analog ASI. So the winner is the Garmin GI275. I find the 275 to be the perfect mix of flexibility, functionality, and cost. According to Garmin, it'll drive the Century 3 autopilot no problem, and it'll of course integrate nicely with the 430 watts that I have in the panel now, as well as use the FlightStream 210 to exchange data with 4Flight on my iPad and iPhone. I love that it's a round dial and fit into the existing panel without having to have a new panel cut. I'm going to leave that for another day. But being who I am, I couldn't fully stop with the two 275s, so I'm also having a GTN 650Xi installed. It'll replace the ancient Collins Navcom unit I have over on the right side of the panel. The thing started to act up a bit lately, so I just decided to get rid of it rather than trying to get it serviced as it slides down that inevitable slope towards being inoperable. Between the GI275s, the GTN 650Xi, and my existing 430 WAS autopilot and JPI engine monitor, I think I'll end up with a highly functional IFR panel. It may not look very pretty, but it'll be really powerful. My local avionics shop ordered the units back in November and December, and they finally arrived from Garmin in March. The installation is slated for the next few weeks, and I'm hoping that by early June, I can start getting some flights in with an instructor so I can get used to that new equipment and a whole new instrument scan. Given the current airspeed indicators in miles per hour, and all the new equipment is going to be in knots, I'm also just going to have to get used to the numbers for things like rotation speed, descent, climb out, approach, and landing, of course. If the installation is done by early June, it'll give me about 6 weeks to get ready for a pretty big flight that I have coming up in mid-July, and I'll talk more about that later. I hope to have some videos of the installation process if I can get away from work. But at the least, I'll put out some videos showing what it looks like afterwards and a little bit of the familiarization process. When I was kind of going through my decision making, I didn't see any videos out there that really show the new GI275s working with a Century 3 autopilot. So, you know, for the people that are out there, maybe that have those old autopilots and are thinking about the same thing, I'll put out a video that kind of shows how well they work together, assuming they do. Thanks for watching. If you liked the video, give it a thumbs up and subscribe to my channel if you haven't already. I'll see you in the next one. And in the meantime, fly safe.